here. Why don't you stand with us? Put your hands together with us. How many know that God is a mighty God this morning? And that was a few of you. Let's try again. How many know that God is a mighty God this morning? We're going to share a new one with you. Sheffield, put those hands together with me. Yeah. We're going to take it back old school real quick.
praise you, Jesus. We serve a mighty God. Amen? We're going to invite the Holy Spirit to come into this place. So lift your hands with me and just do that. Holy Spirit, we welcome you into this place. You are so welcome to do whatever you want to do. Have your way, Jesus. Have your way, Holy Spirit.
Oh, Lord, your presence in me. Your Spirit, Lord.
Your Spirit.
He came to meet with you this morning. Say, I can feel. Whatever your need is this morning, He's here to meet it. Your presence. His tangible presence is here this morning. Say, I can feel, Lord. I can feel, Lord. I can feel your Spirit, Lord. I can feel your Spirit. Touched by your power, Lord. Healed by your power, oh God. Restored by your power. God, mend hearts this morning, God. Lord, heal broken bodies this morning. God, redeem the lost this morning. Say, I can feel, Lord, I can feel. I can feel you moving, Lord. You're moving down this house. You're moving down this house. You're moving down this house, God. In this place. In this place. Say, I can. I can feel your presence. Your hands to him this morning. Can you feel him say, I can
feel.
Come on, say your presence. Lord, we feel your presence this morning.
Presence.
Come on, reach out and touch the hem of his garment. Say, I can feel.
I can feel.
Come on, we can feel your Spirit, Lord. We're calling on you this morning.
Your Spirit.
Come on, let the congregation sing it. Sing, I can feel. Come on, you call on them this morning. Your presence in this place. Your. Come on, call on them this morning. Say, I can feel. Come on, his Spirit is moving this morning. Your Spirit. Come on, sing it one last time. Say, I can feel.
I can
feel. We feel you moving, Lord. We're calling on you.
Your Spirit,
just like Jeremiah. My Lord, we're calling on you this morning. Your presence, Lord,
your presence is.
Come on, lift your hands up this morning. Say, I can
see
your Spirit, Lord,
your Spirit.
Such a powerful anointing in this house right now.
How many feel the presence of Jesus in this place right now? His power and strength. Family, we're going to go to the Lord in prayer today. And we have a lot of families that we want to pray for and encourage. Sister Mama Dana Bickle passed away on the 4th of July. And we want to lift up church family Mark and Lauren Bickle. We were able to share and have her funeral this past Friday. Also, Uetta Moore lost her grandson, Anthony Jamar Ward. They had the funeral this past Friday also. Tragic accident where a powerful young man that just graduated from college got killed and hit in a car accident. And it's hard to press on in those type of circumstances. But family, God is still our source. He's still our shield. He carries us through. His Holy Spirit comforts us and gives us hope when there seems to be no hope at all. We want to lift up Alfredo Gonzalez as he goes. He's going to go to the Mayo Clinic for God to be able to move in the midst of his life and his whole family, Sister Bridget Gonzalez and their kids. We just claim the victory for God to heal his body. Amen. Family, is God our healer? We claim the victory for healing. Whatever's out of order, God can bring back in a moment of time. For many of our other family members that are hurting, let's go to the Lord in prayer today. Lord, we just thank you right now. Lord, we thank you for this opportunity to just give your name praise. Lord, we do feel your presence. We feel your anointing. We feel your power. We feel your strength. Lord, we need to be encouraged sometimes. And Lord, it's hard when we're going through the valley, and Lord, we're going through the pain, and we go through circumstances that we can't see our way out of. But Lord, you're faithful. And Lord, you're our healer. Lord, you're the keeper of our hearts and our soul and our mind. And Lord, when it seems we have no way, and Lord, whatever need may be in this assembly right now, Lord, that your glory would pour out to your people. Lord, somebody may need healing right here in this room. Lord, you're our healer. Lord, you're our strength. And Lord, we thank you right now that we'll just give you the praise. We'll give you all the honor. Lord, we'll glorify your name. We'll praise you in good times. We'll praise you in bad times. We'll cry out to you. We'll give you thanks and say, Lord, have your way. Lord, bring deliverance and peace to your people right now. Encourage and lift up. We claim that victory right now. We give you all the praise, the glory, and the honor. Family, if you believe it, just give God some praise today and tell him thank you, Jesus.
Your spirit in this
Jesus.
Place, I can hear.
Jesus. Give God some praise right now. Is he worthy, family? Give him praise today. If you can, greet somebody with a hug that's next to you. Tell them, I feel the presence of God in this place right now. What a blessing to be in the house of God and share together. See his will and purpose done. He's a way maker, amen? He'll make a way out of no way, amen? How many believe that today? Amen. What a blessing to be in the house of God. How many are happy to be in church today, amen?
How many enjoyed Freedom Sunday last week? Amen. God is so good. He's so faithful. Amen. Do we have any first-time guests that are here with us today? Can you please raise your hand? Where is our first-time guest? Please raise your hand. Let us know that you're here. Give them some love in the house. We see them all through there. Amen. What a blessing. We're so glad you decided to come and share with us today. Amen. Here at Sheffield Family Life Center for God's will and purpose to be done. Right through these double doors to your left, we have a visitor's reception area. Please stop by there before you leave today. There'll be a team of people that'll meet with you and share with you and answer any questions you may have about our church. We have some refreshments, and we have a gift we want to just bless you with. So make sure you stop by there before you leave today. Our ushers are assembled all around our sanctuary. They have debit envelopes in their possession. Anybody here in the house that would like to give by means of your debit card, you can simply raise your hands. They'll find you as quickly as they can. Amen. You can give by whatever means you like. In a few short moments here in service, we'll have that opportunity to bless our Lord and Savior in giving. Amen. Sunday, July 24th at 6 p.m. is, guess what? Family movie night. Let's give a hand clap for that, family. It'll be in the Gene Westlake Chapel. We'll be showing God's Compass. Children's ministry will be available. You can pick up your free tickets today at the Resource Center, the Welcome Desk, or the table that's in the West Lobby to share together, family. That'll be nice. It should be great. The Women's Sunday School class, Lies Women Believe and the Truth That Sets Them Free, begins August 7th at 9 a.m., Koinonia A. Please contact Pat Washington for more information. The Women at the Well Ministry is celebrating their one-year anniversary on Saturday, July 23rd at 11 a.m. at Sheffield West. Let's give them a hand clap for that. Amen. That's a blessing. That's 1215 Benton Boulevard. Please join us for songs, poetry, dance, testimonies, and, of course, food and fellowship. Amen. The Shift Young Adult Monthly Ministry service is tonight in the Gene Westlake Chapel. We have a special guest. Can you stand for me? Andy Estrella, come on, give him a hand clap. Campus director for Chi Alpha, solid brother. I love his heart. Amen. He's going to have a dynamic word for all our Shift Young Adults. Join us and come together. They're going to study the book of James and the challenging perspective of an incredible bromance. Come on now. Doors open at 5:30 and childcare shall be provided. If you turn your attention to our video screens, our announcements will be continuing.
The doctors say you saved her baby's life. I believe that God wants me to be here.
You don't have to bother. I was stealing her car.
My baby was born with blue baby syndrome. One in four don't make it.
Your bail is set at $100,000 for flight risk.
It's not an overnight process to foster. Did you know he has a sister?
The night I helped Jessica.
No.
I can't drive.
I lost her.
Stay there.
He's a criminal, okay? I don't care if he's only 14.
60.
Worse. I thought we were going to talk about this first.
We all have love to give, but the question is, can we forgive?
My mom doesn't know what she's getting herself into.
If it turns out that I just got a few days with my son, to hold him was amazing.
We're going to find your sister. We have to both believe that we're headed in the right direction.
Everybody look at somebody and tell them, I need you.
I need you.
You need me.
You need me.
We're all apart.
We're all.
With I'm gonna say, I need you.
I need you.
Let me hear you. You need me.
You need me.
For we're all.
We're all a part of God's body.
Stand with me.
Stand with me.
Agree with me.
Agree.
Amen. Let's give the Lord a hand clap. Just addressing that, fellas, for all the things that we have going on in our society right now, how many know we need to talk about these things? We need to find solutions for these things. We need to speak to our younger generation to share with them the perspective and understanding of how to literally survive. Amen. And so Pastor George will be addressing at the beginning. We're going to be able to break into groups and talk about this, but we're coming together to discuss solutions and share the plan of action for our community. That's this Saturday, 9 a.m. You know what? If you're all in, just show up. You know what I'm talking about? If you have a perspective, bring it with you, and I hope to see you there. Amen? We do have a dynamic opportunity to share with our marriage ministry. They have a new series starting, How to Financially and Spiritually Free Your Marriage. It's called Marriage and Money. Amen? And they had a wonderful idea, M&M, amen? I don't know if anybody needs some M&M this morning, but I got a few packages up here to remind you. Come on up, sister. I see your hand went on up. Come on up and get your M&M. You want plain or peanut? Come on, somebody. We got choices. Somebody else want M&M? You want the plain. Come on. Sister Janet making her way on down. Now, I don't have enough for everybody. Y'all going to have to share that and break it in two if I can get some more. The baby don't have none. Pastor Randy, make sure the baby gets one right there, amen. If I had extra, I got some gum, amen. I got gum. We'll make sure you get taken care of. I should have had a big bag up here, amen. It's time to get our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, amen. Oh, that sounds like we just woke up this morning. It's time to get our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Come on now, that gave you the strength to make it here today. That is your source of life every day. And because of who he is, and Pastor will preach about this, we give Jesus our first fruits in every area of our life. Can somebody say first fruits with me? You know, if anybody was challenged during the month of faith to be able to give, you know, as soon as you start tithing and start giving God his, how many know and feel the pain and pressure of life that starts coming against you? And as soon as I've given my tithe, then here comes rent due. And here comes issues and something on the car breaks down. You know, the enemy tries to mess with us when we start doing the right thing. But let me tell you this. Don't give up on your first fruits. Keep pressing through and give your way out of that thing. There's no need in going back into disobedience. Now that you've fallen into obedience, keep giving God his first. Family, don't pay your, I even do this. Don't pay your other bills first and then look frustrated at your tithe. That's not, hey, God is the source for you to pay and do everything. Pay that tithe. That's called first fruit. That's that 10%. Put that aside. Give that to him. And you can text your tithe now. Come on, somebody. I text mine all the time. We got that screen that we can put up. You can text your tithe if you haven't signed up. You just dial in the number. There it is right there, 266-4848. Once you simply put it in and put your card in 45 seconds, all you have to do after that is just put your amount. Come on, somebody. That's just beautiful. You can just text that tithe right now. Amen. Not looking at me like I'm crazy. You can just be simply in that place of obedience, just that easy. Family, what God gives you is many opportunities and alternatives to be obedient. All we got to do is follow through and do what his word says. Can I get an amen in the house? Shall we bow our heads together in prayer? Lord, we just thank you right now. Lord, I thank you for simple obedience, the anointing of first fruits, the ability to give unto you and see the blessings of God flow. Lord, all we want in our hearts is just to be obedient, to do exactly what your word says that we need to do. So, Lord, we bless this tithe and this offering right now. Lord, touch the hearts of your people to give unto you. And we give you all the praise, glory, and honor in Jesus' mighty name. Everyone said together. Amen. Amen.
We have the incredible privilege today of dedicating three babies to God, and this would be three families that are saying, as for me and my house, we are serving the Lord, and we will do so. So I'm going to have the pastors who are helping us to come join us in the front, and I'll call the families, and you're welcome to bring any of your guests that you want to bring with you. The first baby is Levi James Daniels. And with the same family, Adriana Lee Daniels. And we have Jason Brown. We have extra pastors if anybody wants to dedicate another child. Or an adult, bring an adult, dedicate an adult. It's an awesome privilege to dedicate children to God in His house. It is the biblical precedent. You don't see a biblical standard of children being baptized or sprinkled. Though I know that's customary with many denominations, religious practices, but the biblical pattern is where children were brought to the house of God and dedicated there in service with their life and their family, their commitment. So today it is that, as you bring your children to the house of God, it's that public statement, public confession of you saying, yes, I'm bringing my child, my children to God today. And we're dedicating our children to the Lord. I tell you this every single time. When we do this, I believe we have stock in God's commerce. And we can say, I dedicated this child to you when they were young. This baby is yours. This life is yours. Because in essence, parents, you are saying, I dedicate myself and my home to you. And as for me and my house, we are choosing to serve the Lord. We are choosing to be the family of God. And it's a great privilege. I know we get used to seeing this, but it's a great privilege to be a part of this dedication with fellow family members. And so these are family members today, and we want to dedicate their children to God. So parents, just simple questions. Will you do your very best to lead your child in an understanding of God and a relationship through Jesus Christ? Will you give your very best example, knowing that no one is perfect? You will make mistakes in parenting. We all know that. But will you do your very best to lead your child, lead your children in following God and honoring God, honoring the house of God, and not forsaking the things of God? Is this your intent? Is this your heart? If so, just respond by saying, I will. We're going to pray a prayer of blessing on them and their children. You can remain seated, but please join with us in prayer as we agree. Heavenly Father, right now, we commit these children to you. God, we ask for your protection. I pray that you would cover them because they are yours. They are being dedicated to you in your house for your service, for life. So God, I pray that you would protect them, cover them. Let no harm come to them. Let no violence come to them on any level. God, I pray that you would give your angels charge over them, give them favor in their life and the things they participate in, the things they commit themselves to, give them health. God, we pray for extreme blessing and health over these children, these families. God, I pray you would raise them up and they would be raised up in the fear and the honor, the admonition of God. Lord, I pray that you would give them a heart for God, a heart for Jesus Christ. Give them a heart to serve God. We commit them to you as best we can. We commit these families to you. So today, God, we dedicate Levi James Daniels to you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. We dedicate Adriana Lee Daniels to you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit today. And God, we dedicate Jason Brown to you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. God, we return the gifts to you that you've given to us, that you've blessed our home with, our family with. We return those gifts to you today for your service, for your protection, for your guidance, for your loving hand and your mercy. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Let's give these families a hand. We have a card and a flower for them, and just thrilled to be part of this endeavor, this decision. Don't let Pastor Kevin take. He'll take a selfie and act like he's tooting, taking a picture of you. Amen. Don't take one of me. Let's give these families another hand. I love the choir. I love when the choir sings. So welcome the choir today.
About God's great love, and he's expressing the width of God's love and the length of his love, the height and the depth of God's love. And I thought about that, and I was like, how can I relate that? How can I in some way understand that? And I think about my own children and how much I love my children and how much I want to do for them and how much I want to protect them and pray for them and bless them and whatever I can do for my children, how much I love my children. But there's one thing that I couldn't do. I couldn't send one of my boys to die for anyone. I just couldn't do that. But our God sent his only son to die for you and I. What kind of love? What kind of love is that? Hallelujah. I thank you, Jesus. I thank you, Lord. Yes, I do. I thank you.
The height of your love,
the depth. Thank you, Jesus.
The
length, the height of your love, Jesus. The depth of your love. I thank you, Jesus, for your unconditional love, Jesus. The way you love me, Jesus. Can't nobody love me like you can. Anybody thank you. Hallelujah, God, we thank you. Oh, we thank you, Jesus. Thank you for loving us so. Thank you for loving us so. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Over. He does it over and over and over and over again. Nothing can separate us from the love of God. Over and over and over again, you show forth your love. Over and over. Over and 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 over. Yeah. You show forth. Your love. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
Going to pray for a couple of things. One is family. If there's more than one person in your family, you probably have some drama and an occasional crisis. I mean, some of your families, I'm sure, are just pristine, but most of ours have some drama and some needs in them. We've had a crisis in the Westlake family this week that I'm not free to share with you, but I want to pray about that. And the reason I bring it to you is because I believe in the power of agreement. I believe strongly in the power of agreement. And I know there are many of you, too, who should join me in that, because maybe you have a crisis in your family right now. There's something that's an emergency situation, a crisis situation. The enemy loves to get in people's lives and mess things up, and loves to get into people's, just their whole livelihood, their home, their work, everything, and mess things up. And we have a responsibility as believers in Jesus Christ, as people of faith, we have a responsibility to stand against that enemy. And not just for ourselves, but for other people. And so I want to agree with you about that and have you agree with me about that, because we all need prayer occasionally. And the people around us need prayer. People we love need prayer. So if you have a crisis need in your family right now and you want to join me in that agreement, just stand where you are, and we're going to agree together in just a couple of minutes. Or if you feel like you need to stand in for someone else, you're welcome to stand. And there's also a situation that some of you already know about. You will hear about quickly. I don't know all the details, but I know the city of Baton Rouge has been very explosive, and they've had several police killings today. There's a major thing going on there right now. And I don't know all the details, so I'm not going to try to give those to you, but it's an explosive situation. And once again, if you weren't in church last week, you've never heard me say this. Maybe once I alluded to it, but I don't sell myself really well. It's not a gift I have. But if you were not in church last week, I would urge you to go on Ustream and listen to the 9 o'clock service. So I shared some things about what's going on in our culture that I think would be valuable for you to at least hear. This is your church. You there was some value in it, you at least hearing that. So I would urge you to pull up that 9 o'clock, 9 a.m. Ustream and listen to that if you weren't in church last week. So we're going to pray for the situation there. One of the things that I hate most about this tension and the injustice that we've seen in our nation, you know, for decades, but it is spotlighted right now, it makes you look at people differently. You know, it makes people look at people differently. You go places and you see somebody and they look at you differently and you look at them differently. And I don't like that. I'm not ever good with that. First of all, I don't like to be judged on, somebody else's evil acts. Just because somebody who has something similar to me in some kind of context has an evil heart doesn't mean that I do, and the same with you. And so, and that's universal. You know, it's a horrible thing, but we're dealing with that in our country, and there's a layer under every major city that's explosive right now, and we need to be consistently praying for that, because there are a lot of people, a lot of things trying to ignite it. And we don't want to see that happen. So we're going to pray for family, crisis in family, and just as we pray for the situation that's happening in Baton Rouge, and just use that as a microcosm of praying for the entire nation and what we're dealing with from all sides, on all sides. Let's call on the name of the Lord. Heavenly Father, right now, God, you know our situation and our family. You know every situation in the house. Though you're an all-knowing God, you're an omniscient God, you are a God who knows every detail. And somehow, we can't fathom how, but somehow you're able to care about the minute details of our life while also knowing and caring about universal needs. So God, I pray right now for crisis situations and families. Lord, I pray for people that the enemy is trying to destroy, hearts and lives the enemy is trying to rip apart. God, I pray for healing. I pray for restoration. Lord, I pray for wisdom. I pray for ears to hear what the Spirit is saying, though they may be inclined to be deaf when they're in trouble and when they're in crisis. But God, I pray that you would give ears to hear what the Spirit is saying and to hear the cry of the Spirit to the heart. So, Lord, we lift these people up. We lift these families up. We lift the situations up. And, God, I pray that you would show yourself. You would demonstrate who you are in these situations as we bring them to you with the little amount of faith that's required to ask and see incredible results. So we deliver these to your throne as best we can. We deliver our needs to you. We give our needs to you. We cast our cares on you in the name of Jesus. And God, I pray for whatever's happening in Baton Rouge, which is just a picture of what's going on in the nation and even the world. God, I pray that you would somehow, and I don't know how this can even happen, but I pray that somehow you can bring some peace in the midst of this storm. God, I pray that you would raise the right people up with the right voices. God, I pray that you would help there to be understanding where there's ignorance. God, I pray that you would help there to be love where there's hate. And I pray that we who know Christ and are Christ followers would be better at demonstrating the love of Christ in spite of everything or anything that's going on around us. Somehow, Lord, help us to demonstrate you in the midst of turmoil. Let us be the light in darkness. Let us be the one to share and to give strength and to give hope and to educate because we have direct line to you. So God, I pray that you would use us, use the people of this church, of this body. And God, let there be peace somehow and let it come through us, representing you. We commit these things to you in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you so much. You may be seated. Got a message that's been on my heart for a while, and I keep bumping it down the road. It's like a can. I just keep kicking it down the road, and it has life. And then I kick it a little further, and still has a little bit of life. And so I'm going to give you pieces of that this morning, as I've kind of dissected it, chopped it up from what I originally had down. And so I will give you pieces of that. I want to welcome my son, Jacob Brown, and his wife, Dion's, a home. They're from New York, Long Island, New York. They're here today as a youth pastor there. It's great to have him here. Today's his birthday, and he's got him a little fresh birthday cut. So if you see him, make sure and give him a big birthday hug, kiss on the cheek. It's always great to have them here. Is he on the big screen? There he is right there. Faith is an amazing thing. We've gone through a faith journey in June, and you may not sense it to the level that I do, but there has been a change. There has been a change in the spirit in this church from 2 months ago. There has been a difference because people are walking in more faith and God is responding accordingly. I'm hearing testimonies every single week. I had a man this morning tell me, he said, I followed obedience to God in giving in June. And he said, I went out of my way to do that, and because I did that, I had the best financial month I've ever had. And I've heard amazing testimonies. You know, we don't always get the best of everything, the brand new. Sometimes it's a discount on a tire that you have to buy. And I appreciate that. Sometimes they ring you up, and this, what you had was 25% off, and you didn't even know it. I'll consider that a blessing from God. You know, I'll take any discount like that. I told you last week about one that somebody called and there was $30,000 of debt. Was that last week or did I tell a group this week, during the week? Did I tell you that last week? I slept twice since then. We had a, tell it again. We had a testimony last week and the number isn't exactly or accurate, but it's ballpark. Roughly $30,000 of debt was expunged, was erased. Someone who committed their giving to God in the month of June. If that was you, you would be clapping a little louder. There's no doubt. I know that raises a twinge of jealousy in most of our hearts. Well, God didn't do that for me, so I'm not going to clap. When we are obedient to God, He gives back to us. And as Pastor Ray said, we give that first fruit. We give that first fruit. And like he was saying, I love the text tithe thing because I tithe almost every day. Well, that's a stretch. About 3 days a week. I tithe about 3 days a week when I used to tithe 1 day a week. And I still tithe that 1 day, but I add 3 more days to it because I actually enjoy doing it. It makes me feel good. It gives me value. I like things that give me value, that make me feel good about myself. So I tithe a lot more now. We've had things change in the supernatural because that's the realm that really change in. When we move in faith as a body, as the body of Christ, big things happen. Spiritual strongholds come down. When we move in faith, when you move in faith in your home, spiritual strongholds will come down in your home. When you move in faith in your life, spiritual strongholds will come down in your business. It spreads all the way across everything. When we move in faith, we function in faith, and we actually begin to live that faith life. I've heard many, many testimonies already in 1 week from Freedom Sunday last week, from people getting houses, to people getting favor, to people being healed. We've heard a lot of things already, and it's amazing. I love all of it, from the greatest to what seems to be the least. God moves, and we give Him credit for that. So continue to be faithful. Continue to be people of faith. Continue to grow in your faith. Continue to give. I'm going to give you the synopsis of a collection of scriptures out of 1 Kings. The crux of it is in chapter 18 of 1 Kings, but you find it in 16, 17, 18, 19. It is about Israel, surprise, surprise. The nation of Israel, but not as we know it. The nation of Israel in this time, in this culture, it was led by a king. His name was Ahab. King Ahab. King Ahab was the most ungodly king to that point. He did evil. You can read it over and over in the Old Testament. The word says he did evil in the sight of the Lord. And some of the evil he did, he was the king of Israel. He was the king of the nation that really believed wholeheartedly in the one true God that we serve. But he erected idols of other gods. He built temples to other gods. And these other gods were tied to things that were very ungodly. Many of the false gods they worshiped, because we don't really get a clear picture of it, because we don't fully understand polytheism, the serving of many gods in the United States. Many nations of the earth still understand that. They still practice that. We don't see a lot of that. We see things as gods. You know, money, items, things, ourself. We see that as God very prolifically in our nation, but we don't see really God set up as gods per se. Is they would set statues up and build temples to gods to say, this is God. And many of them involved fertility and great sexual dysfunction. So they would incorporate a lot of devious acts and devious activities to go along with serving their God. You don't hear a lot about that. You don't think a lot about it. So it wasn't just going, hey, okay, this is your God. There was a whole line of thinking. There was a whole life practice that went along with serving these false gods, and all of it directly went against the commands of the one true God. And so King Ahab had set up gods. Specifically, Baal was the main god, which Baal was typically represented by some sort of cow or calf, which is bizarre to us, but it was. That was the symbolism of it. And so he was an ungodly king. God was very frustrated, very angry. God can get angry, we know that. God, we don't put human emotions on God because it's not exactly like ours. When God gets angry, much larger things happen. I'm angry and going to throw something. Well, he's going to throw a flood on the earth. In this case, he decided to, this for this region of the world, God decided to give famine and drought. Drought produced the famine. So God withheld the natural course of rain and even dew in the mornings. So God withheld this from this region because of their disservice to him. There was a prophet named Elijah. Most of us have heard of Elijah. Elijah was despised by everybody in this kingdom except a few prophets that he had helped save their life. Other than that, everyone despised Elijah. King Ahab despised Elijah. His wife Jezebel despised him with everything in her. But Elijah was still the voice of God and still the prophet. So God told Elijah, and Elijah let Ahab know that he, when he prayed for rain, when God spoke to him to pray for rain, it would actually rain. In chapter 18, it had been over 2 years, between 2 years and 3.5 years, that it since it had rained. Now, we had about a 3-week period when it didn't rain a whole lot, and every day I heard people complain. Imagine going 3 years without rain. Lawnmowers, be gone, which is not all bad. 3 years without rain. And this, and you have to understand, the Middle East is a very dry territory anyway. It's very dry naturally. It's rocky, it's dirty, it's brown, it's dry. And they went almost 3 years, or possibly over 3 years, without rain, which caused famine. So there was great drought, and there was great famine in the land, which means there wasn't enough water and there wasn't enough food that was able to grow to feed the people. In verse 41 of chapter 18, Elijah said to Ahab, "Get something to eat and drink, for I hear a mighty rainstorm is coming." So Ahab went to eat and drink, but Elijah climbed to the mount, to the top of Mount Carmel, and he bowed down and he prayed. And then he said to his servant, "Go and look toward the sea." The servant went and looked, then returned to Elijah and said, "I don't see anything." Okay, we will stop there. Severe drought. Elijah prayed and believed. It was into the third year. So his servant, as Elijah was praying, his servant was told to go check. See, Elijah knew it was going to rain. Elijah knew it was going to rain. We hate the wait. We all hate the wait. God is more oven than he is microwave. God is much more oven than he is microwave. We love that microwave. 90 seconds, 2 minutes, 30 seconds, boom, walk away, wash your hands, come back, and there it is. It's beautiful. We don't care if it's been nuked, duked, or whatever. We just want it, and we want it quick. It's not so fun when you have to put something in the oven anymore and watch it bake. I remember as a child, I used to flick that little light on and look. And the glass would steam up, which really irritated you because you couldn't see. Because you're waiting for this thing to cook. Is it done yet? No, it's been 3.5 minutes. It's not done. It's been like 40 minutes when we had to preheat the oven. I hate the preheating part. I despise the you shouldn't have to preheat an oven. Turn it on. It's hot. I don't want to preheat anything. Well, when you think about it, God is much more oven than he is microwave. Because we go through the preheating process, and then you have to get everything right and put it in there, and it has to sit there and do nothing visible for a long, long time. And you wait, and you hope, and you check it. Has anything happened yet? God, have you moved yet? No, still baking. Still looks the same. Well, give me a fork. You stick a fork in it. It's not done. So you wait. And if you reach in and try to take it into your own hands, you burn yourself. And we do that with God, too. I'm taking this out on my own time, my own way. I don't care. It's, that's hot. We've all done that. We want the microwave. God gives us the oven. So we hate the wait. Progress usually looks more like a maze than a hallway. Elijah knew it was going to rain. So he told his servant, the man with him, he said, go check, look toward the sea. They were on the top of Mount Carmel. Go look toward the sea. See if you see anything that looks like rain. No, there's nothing there. Looks the same. Clear skies, hot sun. Looks the same. Go check, see if anything's happening. Look toward the sea. I just did that. Go check again. I still don't see anything. It looks the same as it did 8 minutes ago. Go check again. This is the third time. Go check again. It's going to rain. Right. Nope. There's nothing there, Elijah. Just relax. Take a break. We'll go check again first. It's ridiculous. This is when we start mumbling to ourselves. It's ridiculous. It's dumb. There's nothing happening out here. No, there's nothing happening. No. There's nothing happening. All right. So what do we do next? Well, go check and look at the sky toward the sea. What? Go check again. Wow! This is ridiculous. Nope. Nothing there. Five times, same answer. We'll go check one more time. No, nothing there. I can just hear some guy laughing off in the distance. At me, laughing at me. Okay, I'm done, all right? It's not going to rain. It's going to rain. Go check one more time. Okay, there's a little tiny cloud the size of your hand off in the distance. And at that point, Elijah said, you better tell everybody that the storm is coming. See, we get so concerned and we think it's not going to happen. It's not going to happen. It's not going to happen. God is not going to show up for me. It looks the same. It looks the same. It looks the same. And then there's one little spark of hope. There's one little ray of light. There's one little storm cloud in the dry heat. And Elijah was enough of a man of God to know if there's one little cloud, you better prepare yourself because God is getting ready to rain on us. So many times, if we will just do one little thing, God will rain on you. God will drop a storm in your world, a storm of blessing. So many times we wait. I heard a great statement. Until God opens the door, worship Him in the hallway. We wait and we wait and we wait for God to open the door and we get lazy, we get tired, and we do nothing. If you worship God where you are, if you worship God doing what you are, if you worship God before He drops the blessing on you, if you worship God in the first six times before you see the little cloud, if you worship God in the hallway, the door will open up for you and the blessing will be there. Now, we can't get content in the hallway because sometimes we create a home there when we weren't supposed to live there. I'll just make my bedroom in the hallway. No, you're going to be in the way, and you're never going to get where you're supposed to be. But while we're in the hallway waiting for the door to open, or while you're outside waiting for the door to open, while you're waiting for God to pour His Spirit or His direction out on you, bless Him and thank Him and worship Him with what you are, who you are, and what you've already been given. I take life for granted so many days. Very few days do I just thank God because I'm alive. But there are those days when I do. And it's usually when something happens to somebody else that could have been me. Thank God for what you have. Thank God for where He brought you from. Don't ever forget where you came from. Don't ever forget what you've been brought from. Now, it's not wise to talk about it a lot because it draws you back. But don't forget where you came from. Don't forget what God brought you from. I'm going to give you a couple lists. And I love that. When Elijah said, go tell the king it's getting ready to storm. It's just a little tiny cloud. Oh, it's going to rain. It's going to rain. I wish we had Andre Crouch's old song, It's Going to Rain, in the background right now. That was a nice song. One, believe before you see. Faith sees what's not there yet. Faith invites what is hoped for. Faith is evidence, as we discussed last month. So believe before you see. Secondly, go when you know. See, we are great at strategizing. How many of you have ever sat in a strategy meeting of any kind? I sit on boards, I sit with groups of people, and people can strategize. It's amazing. Get the whiteboard out. Get the whiteboard out. We're getting ready to make a 2-year plan. We're not making 5-year plans anymore because those aren't any good. We're making a 2-year plan. So we're going to make a 2-year plan, and we're going to break it down into a 1-year plan. Then everybody's going to take a part of that 1-year plan. And if you don't, you're fired. So get your laptops out. We're going to strategize. Well, you strategize and strategize and strategize. And now the big thing is you put giant sticky notes up all over the room. And if you put them up, and it's funny to watch this. Everything is entertainment to me on some level. It's unfortunate for the people around me. Sometimes it's unfortunate for me. But you watch these people put the sticky notes up, and they're working so hard they can't even put them up straight, which is evidence you were really working hard. So they put, see, if I put them up, they all have to be straight, because I would lose my mind if they're crooked. So they have to be, I don't know how many of you are people that get hung up on that stuff. I will focus the entire time on how crooked they are. They're crooked. I can't think. That's me. And so people will stick these things up there, and then they just start writing. And you can't read it. It's doctor's writing. And they slap another one up. It's sideways. I can't straighten it. I'm working too hard. Writing too fast. We can't read what you're saying, but I know, and you will know, or else you'll get fired. There, the room is covered in sticky notes now. We're going to go around the room, and everybody's going to take one. We're going to hand out tasks. Everybody's going to do something. We're going to accomplish great things from giant sticky notes. We're going to strategize. Then we're going to go back, and we're going to get together in 6 months, and we're going to do it again. And we'll say the exact same things and act like it's new. Or somebody else will steal your idea and act like it's theirs. Or I'll steal everybody's idea and act like they're all mine. We strategize and strategize and strategize and put plans together and very rarely accomplish much of anything. So when you know, go. When God lets you know, Go. Well, I've got to think about it for a while. Go. Well, I'm going to wait till this. Go. If God says go, go. If he says do it, do it. Like God will tell me, and usually it's like this, he wants me to start doing something different. It's very rarely like, go to the mall and spend hundreds of dollars on yourself. I can do that. God never says go and do that. He says, I want you to start doing this, which is a chore for me, not something I would choose. And so what do? I will put it off and go to the mall and look for other options. When he says go, you go. Number three, don't doubt because of what you don't see. Don't quit because of what you don't see. See, God is able. Six times, and we don't have a time frame for this. I wish we did. Six times, Elijah's servant went and checked to see if there was anything happening. Six times, it was a no. The seventh time, there was a concession of a small cloud. Just because you don't see something doesn't mean you have the right to walk out on it. Well, I just don't think God's ever going to do anything. I've been going to church here for 4.5 months. I have tithed twice. I gave $8.50 on Freedom Sunday. And God hasn't done anything yet. So guess what? I'm moving down the road. Don't quit just because you don't see the harvest yet. It takes time for the harvest to grow. You don't grow anything overnight. Elijah said, prepare for a storm. Four more things and then one to end with. One, embrace the journey. Embrace the faith walk. We gain from brokenness many, many times. I gain more from brokenness than I do victory. Because when I'm broken, I'm more likely to hear God. When I'm broken, I'm more likely to listen to God. When I'm broken, I'm more likely to attempt what God puts in front of me. So embrace the down times as well. Embrace the faith walk. Number two, outlast your critics. How many of you, when you had a change of lifestyle, suddenly you had a panel of critics who used to be your friends or family? Oh, you're too good for us now. So we're all going to hell. We're going to hell and you're not. That's what my friends used to say to me. Oh, so we're all bad. We're going to hell and you're not because you're better than us now. No, I'm not. I'm not. Just not running that anymore. Suddenly your friends become your critics. You're not going to do this with us anymore. I suppose this is wrong too. It is for me. I have people consistently ask me, can you drink? That's the big question in pastoral leadership right now. Can you drink? I always tell them the same thing. I do have the ability to swallow. I possess the ability to swallow liquid. I do, and I can drink. But for me, you're talking about me consuming alcohol. You know what? I don't cast this on anybody else. But for me, God has said, not a good idea. So I don't. And that's not a medallion on a jacket. That's just God telling me, in following me, I don't want you to do this. And I could give you a whole list, and at some point you'd connect with one of them. So there's always the question, are you too good? Have you changed? What's wrong with you? Oh, you'll be back. I've seen people do this before. You will be back on our side in 6 months. You'll be back going here with us. You'll do this. It'll happen. You'll watch and see. Outlast your critics. Determine in your heart that you are going to remain at least in the lane. There's nobody here who's good enough to walk the straight line all the time. I'm sorry, there's just not. There's just not. Word, thought, deed, everybody gets off center a little bit. It just happens. But stay in the lane. Get in the lane and keep going that direction and keep driving that direction. And if you veer off like I do quite frequently, get back in the lane. Get back in the lane. And outlast your critics. Number three, remember the purpose. The purpose is to make disciples, including yourself. The purpose is the kingdom of God. Building the kingdom of God, making disciples, including you. Number four, stay the course. And this is what I felt like the Spirit of God, as it speaks. It's hard to describe that. But as it speaks, I felt like God spoke to me clearly on the end of this, which is allow God to remove the quit from you. Allow God to take the quit out of your life. Because what happens is we go and go and go. An attempt. I don't know how many of you in the room have ever seen a Rocky movie of any one of the 18 that they've made? Rocky fighting the Titanic. So, of Rocky movies, it's the same story. Whether he's fighting Apollo, Clubber, Ivan Drago, Tommy Gunn, or himself in a mirror. No matter who he's fighting, it's the same story. He goes into the ring. He trains like a machine. On the beach, in the cold, in the gym, in a chicken coop. He trains like a man possessed. And then he gets in the ring and forgets everything he trained for. He gets in the ring and leads with his head every time. What are you doing?
I'm leading with my head.
Why?
So they can hit it.
Why?
Because it's a movie.
So what happens? We watch the Rocky movie, and he gets beat to single IQ level. Boom! They slow it down in slow motion, and you see him moving his head. Everybody beats him. He goes home, and Adrian punches him in the forehead. So he just takes a beating. And you get tired of watching, and you're thinking, okay, he's been hit enough. You need to quit, Rocky. Quit. Just quit. They call it throwing in the towel. Have Burgess Meredith to throw in the towel, who is no longer with us, R.I.P. Burgess. So you have that. And he just keeps getting beat. But we've seen Rocky movies before. And actually, Sylvester Stallone wrote them. So you know who's going to win. You know what's going to happen. He's going to take a beating and come back and win. And we want him to quit. Stay down, Rocky. Stay down. Stay down this time. Drago's too big. And he climbs up the ropes. See, the enemy gets in our heads. And he says, you know what? You've been beat enough. You've taken enough. People have told you enough. God's not come through for you enough. You've waited long enough for this to be done in the oven. Everybody else seems to be getting microwave results, and yours is in the oven. Yours is in a crock pot. You need to quit. And I know so many people who have quit the race. Quit the race. You were in it. You were in it. You were running. You had a call on your life. And you just quit. Why? It just got too tough. Is there anybody in the room who's a follower of Christ that has not had a tough journey? Anybody, really? Oh, you have had one. Okay, thank you. I was going to have you come up here and teach the rest of the service. Finish it out for me, please. It's a tough journey for everybody. Following God is not easy. Doing the right thing is not easy. Being a person of faith is not easy. Because you have an enemy that keeps fighting. You have an enemy who keeps punching you in the forehead. And you have people on the other side of the ring telling you, just quit, just quit, just go ahead and quit. If I were you, I would quit, 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 drop out. You never know. You never know when you're going to go back that seventh time and see a small cloud. You never know when your faith is going to pay off. You never know when you're going to go back and look across that sea that was so empty and see a cloud and say, maybe, maybe God's going to move. Because I promise you this, if you stay faithful, God will pour his blessing out on you. If you stay faithful, God will pour it out on you. And I didn't say perfect, I said faithful. If you stay there, he will bless you. That's why I can tell parents and grandparents, continue to pray for your children. Continue to pray for your grandchildren, because you might be in that 1-6. You might be going back over and over and over and nothing's changed. You will have that day praying mom, praying dad. You will have that day when there will be rain in their life and truth will reign in their life and God once again will reign in their life because you've been praying and you've been going back and checking for a cloud that gives you belief and hope. It will happen. Because I know praying people brings results. It happens. And the enemy will tell you, quit. Quit. You're wasting your time. You're wasting your breath. You need to just disconnect from them. They're going to do their thing. You do yours. If you do that, they will be lost. Keep praying. Keep going back and checking for that cloud. Keep going back and checking. I don't care if you have to check 1,000 times. Go back and check for that cloud because at some point, it's going to rain in a dry land. It's going to rain in a dry land. How many of you in this audience, and I know some of you, how many of you in this audience can say, I am the result of someone else praying and it raining in a dry land? Stand up if that's you. You say, that is me. I am a result of that. And I know some of your stories, and it's exactly right. You are a result of someone continuing to go back and look for that rain. And I am too. I am too. I tell you all the time, if my mom wouldn't have been praying for me every day of my life when she was alive, I would have never made it. Never made it. Because there were a lot of times I didn't want to make it. I didn't want anybody praying for me. I didn't want anybody telling me what was right or wrong. I didn't want to come back to it. I wanted to run and never think about it again. Anybody understand that? But go back and keep checking for that cloud. Because at some point, you're going to see it. You're going to say, wow, that's a really small cloud. I don't know how God can, and it's going to rain like cats and dogs. In the spirit, it's going to happen in your life. So continue to hold on. Here's what we're going to do. Please go ahead and be seated. I love you standing. It makes me happy when you stand. But we want to deal. I want to pray. I want to come down on the floor. I want to pray in chorus with those of you who that sound of quit, that voice of quit, that command of quit is right there for you. You're dealing with it. And you say, well, I can't really go down there because people know me. And this is God's house. This is where it changes, right here. If you can't change it here, you can't live it out there. Impossible. We have to deal with it right here. Because this is a room full of people who are cheering you on, no matter who you are. That's why I can tell you my faults, because I know you love me anyway. This is my family. I appreciate that. So if you're here, you're saying, I don't know that I can do that. I don't know that I can take a step and let everybody know that I'm thinking about quitting, or I'm being really pressed to quit. Then welcome to tomorrow. It's going to look just like yesterday. But I believe in the power of prayer. I already established that this service. I believe in the power of prayer. I believe in the power of agreement. And I believe in overcoming the enemy by the blood of the Lamb and the word of the testimony. Because that's the word. And I want to pray for some of you, pray with some of you who are at that quit point. It's right around the corner. It's pending. And it's being yelled pretty loudly at you. If you're there and you say, you know what, I need that agreement, pride aside, I need that agreement, just come down here and join me in the front, because I want to pray with you. I want to pray with you. I want to pray with you. And this may be quitting the race. It may be quitting consistency. It might be quitting faith. It might be quitting other things that will tear you apart. The enemy will sponsor that in your life. He will sponsor that quit in your life. He will give you the call, and then he will send a car to pick you up and take you there. I need some of you who have bounced back from quit. Some of you warriors who have bounced back from quit. Come down here and gather in front, gather around. We need some people of prayer. You don't have to even make contact with anybody. We just need a ring of prayer. We need people who pray. You can get in the aisles. You can come around here. You can come down here in front with me. We need some trophies. We need some trophies around those who are fighting today. And there are still a few of you, I don't do this typically, I do once in a while, there are still a few of you who are fighting right now, and you're just saying, just get me out of the room and I'll be fine. You're not going to be fine. You're not going to be fine. The quit is all over you. And you got to pray through it. And it's a lot better when you've got some community around you. So if you need to be here and you're not, just come down here and join us. We're going to believe for stamina. We're going to believe for encouragement from God. I'm going to believe and pray that God will encourage you in your heart personally. Sometimes, there's nothing wrong with this, sometimes we just need to see God and sense God in our lives. Sometimes we need to realize that God is on our side and he's for us. And you know, when God is for you, it doesn't matter who's against you. So we just need to know that God is for us sometimes. I'm not ashamed to ask God to show himself to you. I'm not ashamed to ask God to let you know that he's there and he cares about you and he loves you in a tangible way. So I'm going to pray some of that too, because we need to see God. We need to experience God. We need to know God. So let's call out on the name of God right now. Heavenly Father, right now, I agree wholeheartedly in the name of Jesus with these who stand in front of me. Their hearts are crying out for you. There are voices in their head. There are voices around them. There are spirits crashing down on them, evil spirits, demons saying, quit, let it go, back out, bail out. You have no place in this. You'll never make it. It's not for you. It's a bad decision to stay moving forward in your faith. God, I pray that you would give them a sense of victory. Allow them to have a sense of victory today. Whatever that is to each and every person, let them experience you. Let them sense you. Let them know you. Let them even hear you in their heart, in their spirit. God, encourage them. Let them know you love them and you are on their side. And it doesn't matter how many demons yell at them. It doesn't matter how many friends betray them. It doesn't matter how many systems turn them sideways. that you are for them and you're able. And God, I pray that you would give them life where there is death trying to take over. Do not allow the death to overtake them, God. Do not allow the spirit of quit, the sense of quit, to overtake them. Because we know there's hope, God. We know there's hope. We have faith today. I have faith for them. According to your word, I have enough faith to see mountains moved and cast into the sea. Just by asking. So, God, I pray that you would empower these ladies, these men and ladies in front of me. Empower them, encourage them, anoint them, establish them. Give their roots strong hold. Let them be firm in their faith, God. And when the enemy comes in like a flood, raise that standard of spirit around them. Raise that standard of strength around them so they may stand. Raise people up around them to speak life to them and life over them, not death. Give someone the direction to pray for them and encourage them. Allow them to experience life, God, and victory and hope and faith. And God, I pray that they would walk away from this altar area knowing that you're able, knowing that they can walk according to your word by your strength, not their own. Because you exchange strength with us. When we're weak, you exchange your strength for ours. And then we're able to fly. Then we're able to rise up. Then we can keep walking. Give them endurance, God. Cover their spirit. Cover their spirit. Do not allow the lies of the enemy to trick them or destroy them. Let them have vision of what you've called them to and who you've called them to be again. Show them that cloud, that seventh time. Show them that cloud, God. We commit ourselves to you, and I commit them to you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. God is able. God is able. And you know the enemy well enough to know that he's pretty good at his job. So he'll be talking to you as soon as you head up the aisle. But God is able. You made this move because God spoke to you. So remember that when you walk out these doors. Remember that when you get home. Remember that tomorrow when you wake up and it's another day, another week, that God spoke this to you. God spoke this to you. So he has this for you. God has life for you. Let's give God a hand. Let's give God a hand. Let's give God a little praise in the house. God is able. I'm going to ask you, you can stay up here. You can return to your seats. I'm going to ask you to pray one more thing with you, those of you who need to. You need to establish or reestablish relationship with God through Jesus Christ before you walk out these doors. I want to lead you in a prayer. Because I don't want to let you walk out these doors and not have the opportunity to establish or reestablish that relationship. So if you need to pray this with me, pray this after me. Heavenly Father, I commit myself to you. I receive Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior. I choose to be a follower of Christ today. I ask you to forgive my sins, change my heart, change my mind, change my direction. Give me wisdom, strength, and understanding that I don't have. Allow me to walk in your mercy and love every day. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. God bless you. Thank you so much for being here. Be a missionary to your world this week, and I'd love to see you next week. Have a great week.